Greetings, fellow Globe Riders. It's official. The effects of the hypnotic storm have been felt in every country in the world, except for Vatican City and the Marshall Islands.
Luchi.
But you're here now. You're here and safe. And glowing with mirth.
Luchi.
And we're glowing too, because these are days of victory! This is Brain Software, episode 95 with Mike Mandel, and I'm Chris Thompson.
Luchi!
So welcome to level 3 of the Gnaticon. Here is a man who treats life like his own personal amusement park.
I do.
The president of all that's good and true.
I like it.
The living king of Rendlesham Forest.
Bow to me!
Mike Mandel!
Oh, yes, Christopher! Here we go again. Podcast 95, bro. Who ever would have dreamed this would happen?
Oh, yeah.
What a difference between the abject seriousness in the first few, like right up to the abject lunacy that has become our norm.
I remember we had to re-record the intro, I think, on the first one, because it was just like, yes, so, hi, Mike. This is going to be a podcast.
Just so flat.
About hypnosis. And,
other things.
Yes, Chris, we're going to have a good time. This is going to be some interesting stuff. It's like, hello. Okay,
now
we've
back.
Got 95 episodes later. We've got our groove. It's a lot of fun. And
it's
here
awesome,
we are.
Man.
So today, here, we're going to do a podcast today that is all about anxiety.
But yeah, we wanted to be very specific and do one on anxiety because we're going to be doing a live webinar on anxiety for our MMHA students online today. But we might as well stay with the topic. We're coming at this from a slightly different angle with it being about anxiety and a podcast. But we're going to talk about what it is and offer people some creative solutions because we're getting emails and questions about this, aren't we?
Yes, this is the thing. You know, it comes up in the dialogue that we have with our students and with our listeners, whether it be Facebook Messenger, email, whatever, phone calls. People are asking about anxiety, so we may as well do a podcast on it and teach a few useful things. Now, with that said, we are going to go through some other points before we get to the main topic.
The normal opening stuff.
But
right?
I do want to make sure that all of you who are podcast listeners know you can get our stress relief audio product, which is a great one for learning how to crush your own anxiety, learn self-hypnosis, learn some stuff. If stress is a problem in your life and is causing you anxiety, go to MikeMandelHypnosis.com/stress7. The number 7, not the word. Stress 7. Mike Mandel, I could say that again. More clearly, MikeMandelHypnosis.com/stress7.
Is it the number 7 or the word 7?
The number 7.
The number 7. The number 7. Do you notice I didn't interrupt you because you were giving a URL?
Yeah,
I know. It's only taking me about 6 years to realize not to talk when you're doing that.
I think you didn't talk, but you had your brain offline because I said the number 7, not the word.
Is it 7 or is it the word? Scary or losing my mind worse than I am?
Scary.
Okay.
I think you weren't. Okay.
Yeah, warrant your reversal. Very nice.
All right. We're going to do a quick mention as well that, as a reminder, you can find out all about the live events we have going on at MikeMandelHypnosis.com/events. Now, the two that are upcoming the most soon. Does that even sound
no.
correct? The most soon.
The
what
soonest,
the heck is
soonest,
wrong with me?
I think.
The soonest.
Yeah. Suddenly redeemed for the 7 not listening. Yeah.
May 4th, Mindscaping in Toronto. May 5th and 6th, we have Melissa Tears coming in to teach about how to deal with addictions. And then May 14th through 18th, we have the Architecture of Hypnosis, which is actually
sold out, isn't it?
Yeah. I actually have to double check. We may have one spot left due to people who
have
moved.
Shifted to another one. Yeah,
sometimes people will register for May and then say, oh, you know, schedule problems. Okay, no problem. We can move you to the June class. That's fine. But it's all in all likelihood, by the time this goes out, there's maybe one spot left. So if you miss it and you want to come to the next AOH, Architecture of Hypnosis, that'll be June 11th through 15th.
And listen, guys, if you're considering checking out our training, do so by all means. You're going to love it. There's nothing like the live classroom training with Chris and I 5 days together.
Yeah.
The final day, we have the big blowout lunch with everyone. We do the Esdale State. People are in tears at the end of it. People say it's the best week of their life. We will give you the finest boutique style hypnosis training on the planet. Now, having said that, Chris, I dreamed about Melissa Tears last night.
Actually did.
No, it's not an uh-oh dream. She's a friend of mine. But she was in the dream about coming to Toronto. I think we were picking her up at the airport in your Tesla. Then I was suddenly out in a field with a fence. I was telling my wife this morning that ended a chain link fence. There were these two idiots sitting on the ground with bicycles in their 20s, really scruffy guys. One of them started lighting these big kitchen matches and throwing them up in the air. And they were arcing around and then falling to where we were sitting. And I just went over and I did what I said I would never do. I actually used a fist, which of course hurts your hand. Grabbed this guy off his bike, just hammered him in the head, and then slammed him on the ground about 60 times and then woke up.
Are you feeling a little violent or something?
Yes, buddy.
That's just bizarre.
I was protecting my wife from fire.
Okay. That's really
Let's
weird.
Talk about the UK.
We have to talk about the bad news. Oh, so
I know.
This
isn't a joke.
No, this is serious. And Mike and I joke a lot, but not when it comes to this stuff. And unfortunately, so we went to the UK Hypnosis Convention in November.
Had a blast.
Loved it. And we immediately said to each other in the hallway, we're going to make this an annual event. We are so coming back to this conference. And Nick Ebden, who organizes the conference, was thrilled that we were coming back. And then what happened?
We were going to do like one day stuff and everything.
Yes.
So we said, what are the dates? We get the dates. I go home, open my calendar. And right around that time, I've got a corporate keynote on Vancouver Island, which for those of you who don't know Canada, is about 4,000 miles from Toronto, yeah. The other direction.
It's the other side of the country and in the opposite direction as London. So it would have just made the travel unbearable.
Well, because we're coming out of the Canadian Hypnosis Conference where I'm doing the keynote and doing a 4-hour training there, a masterclass, then it would be off to the UK, rushing back from the UK early.
Yeah, you wouldn't be able to attend the whole
conference.
Right,
and teach in Vancouver and then back. And next thing you know, a few days later, it's Architecture of Hypnosis.
Right.
It's too much for a man of my age, Christopher. I just can't maintain
this anymore. Is the thing. We are sticking true to what we tell others to do.
Yeah. Live ecology
a life,
first.
Yeah. Ecology first. Live a life that is going to be good for you. And it is not going to be good for, well, you mostly, because you're the
right.
one you're the one going on that extra gig. But it would not be good for Mike to be doing a presentation
in Canada.
And
you can't cancel on a corporate client. You just can't do it. So
it's just unfortunate. Next year, we'll do a better job of planning in advance.
Yes, we will. What I'd like to do next year, I was telling Carl Smith this, is we go back, we do the London Conference Convention again. We do a pre-thing for Nick at the convention, and then we do Suffolk afterwards and go back to Rendlesham Forest and look
for
the UFO.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so that's all we had to say. Now let's get on to some of the opening points. Before we talk about anxiety, we did have a question that came in from Tammy in Israel. Let's play that audio now. She sent it in as an audio question.
Hi, Mike. Hi, Chris. My name is Tammy, and I live in Israel. I've been listening to your podcast for the past few months now, and I enjoy every minute of it. As I'm an NLP practitioner, I bought a while back a deck of metaphor cards. The specific deck I have is made up of cards that have both words and images on them. My questions to you are, how do I go about using metaphor cards in an NLP session? And is there a chance that a certain image would be too disturbing for the client to handle or cope with? Thanks.
All right, Mike, what do you think about Tammy's question on O cards?
Well, O cards and metaphor cards. I use two different types when I'm dealing with clients. O cards are one specific. Well, I'll come back to them because they're the most complex. Metaphor cards, the ones I use are Mythos, M-Y-T-H-O-S. They're made by the same company. I think it's actually a Canadian company. These things are brilliant. It's like 55 or 52 cards, playing card size. Each one has an original painting on the other side. And the idea is there's no real instructions other than to use them to stimulate the unconscious. And I've used the Mythos cards with clients where I put them in a trance and say, the first card you take out of this pack will show you your problem or will show you the solution. Now, those of you who know my art gallery system of therapy or art gallery intervention recognize this is another way of doing that. The only difference is instead of them drawing a card from their own unconscious, a painting from their unconscious, they're looking at a physical playing card while in a trance. Now, you can do it without a trance, too. The idea is the brain, being a self-patterning system, will match across what it sees in the card to the problem at hand. Case in point, I dealt with a woman who had a lot of stuff, a lot of anxiety, a lot of unhappiness in her life. The card she took from the Mythos deck is the inside of a room. Outside, you can see bright sunlight, and in the room, there's a spinning wheel, an old-fashioned wooden spinning wheel sitting in the corner. She sees this, bursts into tears right away, and said, I'm spinning my wheels inside the house. the new friends and new opportunities are outside, out that window.
I remember you telling me about that.
So they can
one.
Be applied like that in trance. They can be applied pre-trance or after trance. You can hypnotize the person and say, when you come out of trance, you're going to, you know, notice in this card the solution to your problem. But you're an NLP practitioner asking this. So do exactly the same thing. Put the person is in an empowering state, rather, and have him or her recognize in the card aspects that they can map across. If they're in a powerful state to begin with, they will find something. Now, all cards are more complex. It's a deck of large cards with words on them, a single word in each card, with a space in the middle for putting one of the small cards. And in the center, you can put one of the Mythos cards or one of the picture cards that come with the O deck. It is the combination of the picture, right brain, with the word, left brain, that triggers a response. The first time I use them, I was getting my hair cut back when I was a long-haired freak at a place called the Beauty Box, which is kind of a weird place.
That's a weird name.
Yeah, it was nice. But I was getting my hair cut. It was a rainy day, and I was sitting in the lobby waiting, or in the waiting area, waiting for Jennifer, my stylist at the time. Now I just buzz it with a handheld thing. And she came out and saw me with these O cards I just bought. She said, oh, are you reading your tarot? I said, no, I'm not into that. This is an unconscious trigger. Because I was on my way to Australia for the very first time, 1990. And the cards, I felt this weird anxiety and stress. And the cards that came up, Chris, it was a hand holding a pair of scissors, and the word was separation. And the instant I saw that, I realized consciously.
You don't like being away from home.
It's the first time I was going to be away from my wife for such a period of time. And on the other side of the planet, meaning if something went wrong, it's going to take me days to get home.
For a guy who is security-minded.
Security-minded.
Like
and instantly I understood it. So you can use these in a lot of ways. Let your creativity go wild. The O cards, the Mythos cards are amazing.
Now, I am guessing that you would probably agree with the statement that it is better for the client to be in a relaxed state when they are looking at these cards to allow it to have the maximum effect.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. In fact, if you're going to get them in a relaxed state, you can have them get there by the 7-11 breathing that we're going to be talking about later in this podcast.
Perfect. Okay. So that handles the question from Tammy in Israel. Thanks for sending that in. And remember, folks, you can record your questions. Keep them under a minute. 30 to 60 seconds is ideal. Just record it on your smartphone, introduce yourself, where you're from, and email it to us, info@mikemandelhypnosis.com.
And we will answer you.
Insert it into the next podcast. All right, we've now got a question that came in by email. Do you want to introduce this one, Mike?
Well, yeah, have you got the email there? Are you going to read it?
No, I don't have it here.
I might be about to sneeze here, Chris, but we're going to do it. We're not going to edit it out. We're going to say we're going to edit it out.
Okay, so we're just going to pretend. Oh, don't do it. Don't do it.
In the Kleenex.
All right. So the question was about George Dillman.
Okay. Now, it's just a tricky thing. An email came in from one of our listeners who's a martial artist. He's black belts in multiple systems. He's interested in the fact that we do, you know, British jiu-jitsu. He does a number of other things. Anyway, he's been watching some of the stuff with George Dillman on YouTube. And Dillman is known for having a 10th degree black belt in some system, and he does a lot of things. I think David Snyder is trained in his system, and which is in his favor, because David Snyder, our friend, is somebody I really respect as a trainer and as a martial artist. So I'm going on record as saying that. But some of Dillman's stuff, when I've seen him touch someone on the wrist and on the neck, and then the person falls over like they're unconscious. And
like
then they're being
revived. He just touches them on the wrist and touches them on the neck, and then all of a sudden I'm going to go unconscious.
Right. And so there were people who were very, very skeptical of this and thought it was suggestion, you know, a light form of hypnosis happening, anticipation, prestige. This is George Dillman doing it, so it's going to work.
Yeah.
And so I've seen other videos where a guy goes up and Dillman touches everything, and the man just looks at him. But it was Dillman's explanation I thought was ridiculous. He said, oh, you may have been raising one of your toes, your big toe on one foot, or you may not have believed in it. Let's rewind. You can watch this on YouTube.
We're adding in complexity.
We are.
This means it goes against Occam's razor.
Of course, we're adding in complexity. But here's the problem. Think of the second explanation, Chris. Not that you may have been lifting the big toe on either foot inside your shoe. That's why it didn't work. But perhaps you didn't believe in it.
Yeah.
Now, if I'm in a martial art where the guy has to believe in it for it to work, I don't want to be in that martial art.
Okay. Also, if you're practicing a martial art where the guy must not be accidentally, unconsciously lifting his right toe on his foot, I'm sorry, it's not a reliable technique. How about you chin jab him instead?
Now, right. Now, I do believe in pressure points. We use 12 primary ones in our system. And I know a lot of this stuff is very powerful because Mike Mason, one of our students who's multiple black belts, trained with Dillman, and he could do things like shut down our salute by putting his hand on his hip.
Absolutely.
And, but I'm not believing these one-touch knockouts until I have more information. I think it is prestige happening. I think the social compliance happening. And
pressure points are striking points.
Generally speaking.
All right. So there, that answers that. We're not believers in the tappity tap tap on the pressure points and guy goes unconscious.
Well, wait, no, but we are believers in the tappity tap tap on the pressure points and
gets rid of anxiety and stuff. Yes, when it comes to anxiety, absolutely. That's totally different. That's not attacking someone. That's fixing your own issues.
Exactly.
Okay, now, we also wanted to have a quick conversation about, and we're already 15 minutes into this podcast.
I know, it's good.
So, let's talk about mind reading. Mike and I use Voxer, which is a walkie-talkie app on our phone.
App.
We talked about it on Voxer the other day, the idea of mind reading. And so people, now this is why it came up. Oftentimes, because we are communicating.
Wait, you have to define your terms first of all. You don't mean telepathy.
Not explaining what mind reading is.
You don't mean telepathy.
No. Mind reading, and that's why I was about to go to.
Yeah, okay.
So thanks for mind reading.
That's all right.
So when we say mind reading, what we mean is that somebody assuming you should know what they mean, even though they haven't done a very good job of communicating it yet. And it's quite annoying when people will say to something, well, you only think, do you want to elaborate?
Mind reading, the NLP term, is mistakenly believing you know what the other person is thinking.
Without asking.
Yeah,
or
you only know if they tell you. Yeah. Well, you think, I remember I said some of my insane relatives through marriage, they begin every conversation by telling, argument, by telling the other person what the other person is thinking.
Yeah.
You think that you can just, and you, it's crazy because we can't read minds, six of clubs. but then this reverse mind reading, if you really loved me, you'd know that I think that, no, we can't, don't anticipate that other people should be reading your mind either. Clear, cogent communication is the way, is the answer. Yeah.
Loving someone doesn't require you to have mystical abilities to read their mind.
Right.
So
that drives me crazy, though.
So one of the things that has started to bother me a lot is when people will email in for some sort of support issue. And I'm not picking on anybody in particular. This is certainly not unique to our customers or the people who email us or our listeners. Some of you are guilty of this. Some of you are not.
Some of you are really guilty of this.
Yes, I'm mentioning this to you so you can start to become consciously aware of when other people do this to you or when you're doing this. If you're doing this, there you go. So here's what'll happen a lot. Somebody will email in and say something like, well, I couldn't buy this product. It didn't work. And what they mean by that is, well, I don't know. There's a bunch of things that could have gone wrong, right? Their credit card was rejected. Maybe the order form didn't load. Our website has crashed.
You have zero information to work with.
So when, and I could go on and on about different examples of this. I couldn't log into the site. It wouldn't let me. No. It's not that it wouldn't let you. Something went wrong. You haven't sent me any details about the issue. This metaphorically, I feel like replying a lot of the time saying, you know, I went to the doctor's office and I told him, I said, the advice from that other guy didn't work. What should I do?
Oh, Lucci.
It's like, how is the doctor supposed to mind read what the other advice was, what the problem that I'm having was? He doesn't even know anything about it.
Mind reading and reverse mind reading. I know you're always, well,
call it the doctor metaphor.
This is crazy.
Yeah.
He said, listen to what the person said to me. I have no idea what the product is, what they're talking, nothing. Give me some information.
Yeah. So,
but you are a bit of a stickler for that, to be fair.
Oh, for sure. I am. Yeah, I am. You know, being an engineering type,
and
I want full details, right?
One, yeah.
So do not sip from the bag of pickthos before you communicate with others. Communicate clearly. And the secret that always works is simply put yourself in the other person's shoes. If what you just said requires information that they do not have, you haven't done a very good job of communicating. So just think about that. Think about that in your life, and we would love to hear back from you, either audio question, examples, etc., for our next podcast about examples of mind reading in your life where you've been guilty of it and this suggestion that we're giving you has helped, or people are doing this to you and how can you overcome it?
Or reverse mind reading.
Right.
You should know what I'm thinking.
All right.
Good one.
Now that we're nearly 20 minutes in, let's talk about anxiety. And how about we start with Charles's audio?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Play that one
for us. All right. So we're going to now play for you a, I think it's about 47 seconds of audio from Charles, and then we'll come back, that serving as our preframe to the topic of anxiety.
My name is Charles, and I have anxiety and panic attacks. I want to get these things under control, and that's my question to you. I'm a marathon runner that has had 2 massive heart attacks. The doctors did not tell me to stop running either. And while I'm running, if I feel dizzy, I go into a state of panic. I want to actually fall down on the floor and call 911, or I carry nitroglycerin. How can I address this problem in my head? I know it's a head thing, and you guys can help, please.
Well, it's important to mention, Chris, right off the bat, that we are not talking about phobias here. We're not talking about, oh, fear of snakes or anything of that nature. I'm not even talking about agoraphobia. Anxieties are analog, where phobias are digital. So right. Phobia switches on and off, whereas an anxiety tends to build gradually. And for our definition, we are going to say that anxiety is always a trepidation about the future.
Right. Something that, and it could be based upon past experiences,
right.
Something that happened. Like, for example, Charles just talked about in his audio that he'd had a couple of heart attacks in the past. So
yes,
obviously that could cause you massive anxiety, worrying about future events.
Yes,
like that.
That's right.
But it is not a digital thing. When we say digital, think of a light switch going on
or
off. The light is either on or it's off. That's typically phobic responses. Anxiety, you can think of anxiety analog, that dimmer switch. It starts maybe not even being something you're thinking about, but then as you start to think about it and make pictures in your mind and say things to yourself,
comment on it internally,
you're like dialing up the intensity of that light until it's blinding.
Which is why we now have to make the initial point that the key to overcoming anxiety, and Melissa Tears has done some phenomenal work on this, so has Richard Bandler. One of the keys is you must jump in on it as soon as you notice it.
Yes.
In fact, with any habituated pattern, whether it's an addictive craving, whether it's worry, whatever it is, you must learn to work with the plasticity of your own brain by jumping in on it as soon as it begins. That's how you're going to rewire your brain. Remember, guys, this is neuroscience. We're not talking about trying to convince yourself to be a different way. We are talking about changing the electrical wiring inside your head.
The metaphor that this is, I don't know why, this is painting in my mind, is imagine you're in a movie theater. I know you'll relate to this, Mike. And some dick in the front row out his cell phone and starts reading email. And
we're talking about this last night. Heather and I were talking about this last night.
You know, I haven't talked about this at all. So imagine you're in this movie theater and some guy starts reading his bright cell phone. If you're the security guard, let's say you're the security guard and you're watching this happen, are you going to shut that guy down right away? Or are you going to wait until 30, 40, 50 other people are all reading their cell phone, annoying everyone else in the theater? Shut it down. That's what I mean by it's analog. It starts to...
Annoying. Lucci.
Yes.
That's become my new swear word because it's absolutely...
Lucci.
Lucci.
We love
meaning. You know, Chris, if you're going to do the British Jiu-Jitsu method, if the guy was actually violent, I recommend you get behind the person. This is typical World War I. No, I wouldn't even do a Sestari choke. Grab the person's head from the forehead, from the back. Or the front of their hair and abruptly haul back and down and you'll... the spinous processes together. Now, this is a life-taking move, so I'm not recommending you do it unless your own life is in danger. Now, let me talk about how anxiety can happen. Let me give you an example from my own life, Chris. I went through a phase where if I was on the road and went to phone home. Now, remember, cell phones came in, started to become common in 1990, the first ones. That's when I had my first Panasonic, which was the size of a small suitcase.
Yes.
Prior to that, when I'd be driving to a gig hours away, Ottawa from Toronto, whatever, or landing in a different airport, I would phone my wife from a payphone because that's what they're worried.
That's what existed
back then. Carry quarters and phone home. And if I phoned home and she was expecting I was going to phone home and she did not answer, I would start getting a horrendous anxiety.
Of course, you'd worry. What happened to her?
Really
Where is
bad.
She?
Yeah, why
What's
isn't
wrong?
She there when she knows I'm calling?
Right.
She never misses a phone call. So when I'd go somewhere like Australia, I'd have to tell her what time I'm phoning. Say, do not miss this. Because if I had to go on stage afterwards, this would be in the back
it
of my mind constantly.
It would be playing.
But do you know why that started? Chris, I can tell you exactly how it started. I found the initial causative event. And there isn't always one. But in this case, I was a kid, probably about 9 or 10. little kid, very small, as you know, a small, skinny kid like you were. And we lived in an apartment. This is 1963. I got up in the night, woke up, I'd had a nightmare. So think of your own kids, Drusilla and...
you're struggling and, to come up with
Dentistrica.
Some. Oh, there we go.
Drusilla and Dentistrica. She's got okay. dentist in her name. So in the night,
in the dark,
I wake up having had this horrendous nightmare. So I call it to my mom and dad, and there's no answer. So I get up and I walk into their bedroom, but it's about 11:30. They're not in their room. So I come into the living room, and this three-bedroom apartment, they're not there.
Uh-oh.
They just aren't there. And I had no idea where they were. I remember sitting on the couch and just crying, being terrified.
Wow.
Like, where are my mom and dad gone? And they were next door, visiting the Lawsons, the apartment next door. They came in like an hour later and saw me sitting there terrified.
Oh, man.
So the lack of contact became the initial sensitizing event. And now, of course, I don't get that because I can phone home and be in touch pretty well anytime. But that kind of anxiety, that kind of fear, it can be crippling for people. And some people have free floating anxiety where there's no known cause. They're just sort of always feeling terrible. What freaks you out? Do you get anxiety at all?
No. Today I don't.
Liar.
I don't think that I... In fact, I've been thinking about this a lot since we planned to do a podcast on this. And I realized the reason... I was just telling my wife this the other day. I said, there's a reason that I don't have any anxiety in my life. And it's because I don't sit around obsessing over negative things and giving myself negative messages or anything like that.
Try for a couple of weeks and see
what
happens.
You know, it would probably depress me and I just want to get a sharp knot. No, I'm kidding. But in the past, my only anxiety that I can really think about remembering that happened to me is one time when I was a high school student, I remember getting into this weird state. I think I was probably worried about exams or something. And I was in this phase where I felt that if I didn't consciously breathe, that I wouldn't get enough air.
So you felt like the breathing was not automated.
Yeah.
It was something you were doing consciously.
And the crappy part is if I started to notice that I was breathing, then I would think I had to be consciously breathing and I couldn't just let it go back to an unconscious process or I wouldn't get enough air. And I remember it was pretty late at night and I went into my parents' bedroom and I said, I'm having this problem. And I described it. I didn't know what it was. My dad just said, oh, that's an anxiety attack. And explain to me exactly what it was. And he taught me, well, you know, breathe into a bag or whatever kind of thing.
Yeah.
What I realized is if I started singing a song in my head, that would force breathing back into an unconscious process after maybe a minute or two.
Well, that's
interesting. So that was my solution.
You're singing a song in your head, you're switching on your right brain. You're getting bihemispheric function all of a sudden. Now, that's very interesting because that's one of the things we're going to talk about.
Yeah. Here. Oh, that makes sense. Okay. Because this really gets to the next point about how anxiety is a behavior, right?
It's something you're doing. This is our belief. We're giving you our opinions. We're not diagnosing. We're not treating for specific things. We're giving you our opinions and telling you things that we have found have worked.
Right.
So, we believe anxiety is not something that is happening to you. It is not your identity. I am anxious.
Yeah.
When I had a client come in and say, I am anxious, I used to laugh and say, oh, I thought you were Susan, you know? Yeah. And we laugh. Ha, ha, ha. But it's something you are doing. It is a behavior and that results in this profound kinesthetic shift, a feeling shift, a bad one, and you can change it.
And remember, before we get into all these next things we're about to say, remember what Mike said earlier. The moment you start noticing these neurological paths being lit up, deal with it immediately.
Immediately.
So the stuff we're about to share with you, start using this the moment that little spark of a fire begins.
Yes, and start to track your own life and determine when am I anxious? How do I know when to be anxious? What happens? What's the very first thing that happens? Get the strategy. Oh, it's when I imagine that the house is burned down while I'm away. Whatever it is, learn to recognize the initial step and jump on it instantly. We're going to give you one method right now, and this comes from our awesome friend Kevin Lay, who's a phenomenal trainer, and check out his stuff. It's called PsyTap,
PSY-TAP.com.
Yeah. Kevin is in England. He does conferences and trainings around the world, and he's brilliant. And he taught us this, and I have used this myself, and I taught it to people, and it works. When you start to feel anxiety, which will then become a panic attack, even if it's that severe, all you do is hold out your non-dominant hand in front of you. So if you're right-handed, you're going to hold your left hand out with the first two fingers sticking out, palm up towards yourself. Like he said, it's the James Bond gun picture. Take your other hand and grip those two fingers right down by the base, a full grip around your first two fingers of the other hand, and squeeze with your dominant hand. Not hard enough to hurt, but hard enough that you'd be able to feel a pulse and hold it. And then what happens is this acts as an eraser and wipes out the anxiety. Do it for a few seconds or a minute. Take your hand off and see, is it still there? If it's there, do it again. Just keep doing it. And it starts to generalize very quickly. I found this to be phenomenal. You want to mention the Pakistani girl on the plane to the UK. Me, Chris, and Michael C. Anthony flying from Toronto.
I was the furthest away because you two were in the same side of the plane as her. But she expressed what? She was 18 or 19
18,
years old.
19,
it was her first time ever flying overseas alone. Yeah. And she was very nervous. And Mike just thought,
you guys are hypnotists. Yeah. She saw our shirts and she said, can you do anything about anxiety?
Well, you just taught her this finger squeeze technique.
Yeah, right away we're just flying and she got really nervous. And I said, our friend Kevin Lay showed us this. See, Kevin, I've said your name again. And squeeze these two fingers and hold and just think about the problem and squeeze. Keep squeezing. She did for maybe 10 seconds, 15 seconds. And she just looked at me and she said, okay, that is really bleep weird.
Yeah.
And she was totally freaked out by it, how it just switched it off instantly.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's all kinds of things that you can do like this. In fact, we talked about, was it the last podcast that we talked about the dealing with emotional issues and the tapping? Because you can tap on anxiety
as well. Use my six-step tapping the second this begins, and you'll find that you can erase stuff right away. But there's so many different things. Now, I mentioned the 7-11 breathing.
Okay, let's talk about that.
It's really cool. When you breathe, every time you breathe, you know you have a pulse rate, of course, and it may be an average of 70, 72 beats per minute. But what you may not have known is it's not consistently 70, 72 beats a minute as you're sitting there. As you inhale, your pulse actually speeds up.
Speeds up a bit,
as you exhale, it slows down again. And this is a seesaw between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. So when you're breathing in, there's a tension, there is an increase of pulse at that time. When you exhale, you are firing the
parasympathetic
nervous system based on the vagus nerve in your neck right down through your body, and your pulse slows down. It causes relaxation. Now, the key is if you make the exhalation longer than the inhalation, you are stimulating the parasympathetic, which is geared to relaxation, calmness, and lower blood pressure and slower breathing.
Yeah, now we call this 7-11 breathing, but there is no rule that it has to be 7 beats inhale, 11 beats exhale.
No, it's just a really easy one to do, and it's useful.
If you want to think of another way, just think of double. So exhale for twice as long as you inhale.
Yes, that's right. And it works very well. So if you're timing and you find your inhalation takes 4 beats, just exhale for 8 beats.
Now, remember, we said earlier that being in a relaxed state will really help you when it comes to using these techniques. So this is a great first step. If you catch yourself with those neurological pathways being lit up, those anxiety pathways, do this as step one. Do something like this to relax.
Well, here's the thing, Chris. Here's where my freaking genius comes in.
All right.
Listen to this. I recommend you grab the two fingers, Kevin,
and do the 7-11 breathing.
You're a genius too.
There you go.
And do the 7-11 breathing. Keep your arms and shoulders relaxed as you do it. And notice the anxiety fade. Mm-hmm. It's so incredibly brilliant how fast this will work.
So
it was Larry Nims who said, notice and treat, notice and treat. When I studied with him with
notice
Craig
and Cutton, treat, good.
Ron Varigan, we went to Oakland, California. We say San Francisco because they're next to each other. And we studied with Larry Nims there, Be Set Free Fast. And he said, notice and treat. And it's a great thing. Notice what you're feeling, do a treatment on it. Then notice how you're feeling again. Is it still there? Do a treatment on it. Just keep noticing and treating until it's gone or you feel much, much better.
Absolutely. Makes a lot of sense.
Now, let's talk about bihemispheric stimulation because this is an important one. I got this from Melissa Tears. I'm not sure where she got it, but the whole idea, you can get something like a rubber ball or any kind of object, an eraser, a pen,
a marker.
And when you start to feel the anxiety coming on, you pass it hand to hand in front of you, opening your hands wide as you do it.
Looking at it.
Looking at it, watching it go side to side and opening your hands. So it's always crossing the center line, moving your hands in a wide arc as you go side to side, pass it right to left to right, and keep doing it. This stimulates both hemispheres of the brain. As John Grinder said, how can't remember the name of it.
Don't worry.
Did you think
it.
I was having a stroke?
No, yeah, I thought you might be.
I like how I sort of leaned in towards him and went, whoa.
I thought you were actually gonna get whatever.
EMDR is what I was trying to say. Well, I did get it. I paused long enough. EMDR, yeah. The eyes are going back and forth. Right? Bihemispheric stimulation.
Yeah.
And by firing both hemispheres alternately like this, you can often reduce it to a large degree very, very quickly. Another one to use.
You'll hear people use the phrase bilateral stimulation as well.
Right, biatheric.
It's the same thing.
It's exactly the same thing. I've never found a difference.
Okay, so that's a really simple one. Another one is just to make sure that if you catch yourself saying things, making mental pictures, using words, change how you talk to yourself.
Change the voice.
Change the words, change everything about it to make it, you can change the submodalities. You can, you know, if you have some negative talk going on, change it by having it in some sort of funny cartoon voice.
Like Mickey Mouse or something, or make it a ridiculous voice. The thing that's saying, oh, your house might have burned down. Turn it to, your house might have burned down, your house might have burned down. And then it'll become ridiculous. Let's give one more, and because we're moving on here, but we're going to give you a very powerful one here.
All right, what's the next
one? This is one I got from Melissa Tears. I think she got it from John Overdurf, and I think he got it from Richard Bandler, and it's the spin technique. And basically, to feel any kind of emotion, you have to feel it in your physical body.
Yes.
So in order to feel this, you imagine this. Feel a sensation in your chest or whatever. Where am I feeling this anxiety now? So you start to notice, and then notice which way is it spinning? It will be moving. So if it isn't moving, you can't feel it. So you will draw with your hand the direction that this is rotating in front of your body and feel it. Now just imagine it pops out in front of you in space and is still rotating there, and you're feeling it out in front of you. Now reach with your hand.
Don't imagine it. Do it with your real hands. Turn it the opposite way.
We're getting a bit of kinetic shift tying in here, if you really think about it. So you're spinning it the opposite direction in front of you, even faster and faster, and then jam it back inside you and notice how it's changed. Mm-hmm. You're changing submodalities, been in a very, very powerful way. And this can, and what she adds at the end, she says, now add some humor, add some laughter. When you've got it going the other way, laugh about something out loud, deliberately laugh, and then slam it back in and laugh and notice it's changed. It has absolutely changed that
you
quickly.
You are changing neurology when you do this. You're changing the way your body's brain works. Another thing you can do with that is, so let's say you elicit it from a client. If you're working with a client and you ask them, what color is that feeling? And they tell you it's blue. And then you do this spin thing. And once you reverse the spin and slam it back in the body, you can ask, what color is it now? Implying that it's changed. And almost every time it has.
It will. Yeah.
Excuse me.
If it's still there, something you don't like, take it out, spin it again a different way. Put it back in, add the laughter. Anchoring the laughter to it is very, very clever as well.
So lots of things you can do. And also remember, MikeMandelHypnosis.com/stress7, the number 7, not the word.
Check that out. Number 7 or the word? Excellent. Chris, it is my understanding something quite remarkable has happened. And I hear that there has been yet another Gus Grissom sighting.
Yes, there has, Mike.
Well, Chris, let's have the update.
Mike, there has been what I suspect is the final Gus Grissom sighting. This information arrived by email just a few days ago and is truly astonishing.
Tell us about it, Chris.
This came in from Elon Musk at SpaceX.com. He writes, as you know, Chris and Mike, SpaceX is the world's largest and most successful private space exploration company. It has long been my dream to put a man on Mars, and it appears that we are nearer to that accomplishment than we ever imagined. The entire planet watched in awe as the Falcon Heavy rocket test flight went essentially without a hitch, sending a Tesla Roadster on its way to the red planet. We were all thrilled to see Starman in the driver's seat with the pleasant words, "Don't panic," on the screen in front of him. But there's another aspect to this that we've been reluctant to release, but do so now in the interest of full transparency. Once the launch was completed and the boosters had safely landed again, someone noticed that Starman was moving. At first, we thought that it was a raccoon or another animal that had climbed into the rocket, but there was definitely a human being inside the spacesuit. He took off his helmet, and although I could only see the back of his head, I recognized that brush cut. It was Virgil Gus Grissom. I have no doubt that it was him. I saw his eyes in the rear view mirror of the Roadster, and although he seemed a little tired, Grissom looked fit and happy. He gave me a salute and then switched off the camera, ending the transmission. Musk went on to say that Grissom must have been planning this trip for months or years in order to flawlessly slip undetected into the SpaceX compound for the launch and ensconce himself in the Tesla Roadster. The head of Shizjig Security, Jack Ruby, was unavailable for comment.
Unbelievable, Chris. So this may be the end of it all. And Gus, if you're listening, we wish you God bless and safe travel to Mars.
Man, what an interesting ending to this long story.
Oh, what a saga this has been. It's been an odyssey for all of us, Chris, for everyone listening. Okay, Chris, it's time for the empowering question, and I think you've got one for us.
Yes, I do. Here it is. What makes you anxious, nervous, or afraid? And what will you do to shut it down the next time it starts happening? What is the greatest producer of anxiety in your life? And what are you going to do to deal with it immediately to have a better life?
Excellent, Chris. And my metaphor is a quick one. It's a man I mentioned before, Howard Roach, the scariest dentist in history. In Toronto at Greenwood and Danforth Avenue was Howard Roach. I went there first when I was 4 years old. We came over from England. He yanked out some baby teeth with such force, such power. I wound up in Toronto East General Hospital bleeding from the gums. I remember noticing because I had a cup of hot chocolate and looked and there was blood in it. They were checking my blood pressure. It was terrifying. And from that moment, I became terrified of the dentist and was for many, many years. I'd have anxiety going there, panic attacks. He worked with nitrous oxide, would strap it on your face and you feel like you're I would feel like I was suffocating. Hear me dissociating. But over time, guess what? Dentistry improved. I went to a different dentist and all the anxiety disappeared.
Thanks, everybody, for listening to Brain Software Podcast. This has been episode 95 with Mike Mandel, and I'm Chris Thompson. Remember to send in your questions. You can email them to info@mikemandelhypnosis.com. Just record them on your phone and send us the audio file. Keep it to 30 to 60 seconds. And make sure you check out mikemandelhypnosis.com/stress7. See you in the next episode.
See you then.
When I woke up this morning, I was feeling fine, but this cat started banging, man, what a swine. So I called reception, but to no avail. That's why I'm telling you the story still. It went bang.
I said, shut up.
It went bang. I said, wrap up. Well, I'm aware that guy must do his work, but a pile driver man drove me berserk. He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what?
He said, Captain. I said, what?
He said, Captain. I said, what you want? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what you want? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what you want? He said, Captain. I said, what? He said, Captain. I said, what?